When did slavery become a criminal offence in England?
It was not in the 1960s. One of these odd little new Labour laws in about 1996,
7, 8. What an odd law to outlaw slavery. Is political correctness gone mad?
Odd in the sense it's a bit late.
Yes, that's exactly right. It was 1807 when the slave trade was ended, and then finally in 1834, it was illegal anywhere in the British Empire to own a slave. It has never been illegal to have a slave in England until April 2010. Oh. I'm saying I could have had you as a slave legally.
You mean this series, I'm finally free?
Yes!
But you know what? I mean, one of those slaves who just goes back to the master. I don't know what to do. I work for you anyway, please.
One thing is that there are now estimated to be 27 million people held in, essentially, in bondage, in slavery on this planet.
But the show will be over soon.
More,
you can go.
Yeah.
Right now?
More than there ever were in the days of cotton picking and so
27
on.
Million?
27 million.
In the world?
Yeah, that is the estimate. It's a pretty grim problem still, slavery. The point is, it was never illegal in England because it was never recognised as a state of being. There were laws against kidnapping and abduction and false imprisonment and sexual trafficking and all the other things that we might associate with slavery. But it was not illegal for one human to own another human, which it now is.
So this is a law that this isn't one of those laws where they thought, oh, that needs to clearing up. It's a loose end from history.
It kind of was. In 1967, there were a number of obsolete crimes that were taken care of. Barratry had been illegal right up to 1967, which is vexatious lawsuits.
Oh, okay.
Building of
vexatious
lawsuits.
Yeah, what they call a vexatious litigant, somebody just keeps
carrying. Dorothy Squires.
Yes.
Dorothy Squires, the singer Dorothy Squires, towards the end of her life when she did have a mania, but she was probably the last person to be done for vexatious litigant.
And if you kept prosecuting someone for it, you'd be prosecuting
yourself.
Yeah, well, it's completely. Anyway, there's scolding. Scolding was a crime in 1966, but not in 1967.
With hot water, you mean?
Not scolding. Scolding. No. Scolding!
That was a crime.
You! What time of the night do you call this, Eddie Izzard?
12.
Yes.
12:30.
Well, I'll give you a good scolding.
And that was illegal?
That was illegal.
Illegal?
Yeah.
And that was legal?
Eavesdropping was illegal. Challenging someone to a fight was also illegal until 1967.
What about going round and round and roundabout more than three times?
It certainly wouldn't have been a medieval law, would it?
Well, I don't know. And if you had a horse and cart, you had a couple of hours spare.
On a medieval roundabout.
On a medieval roundabout.
Yes. Anyway, there you are. Due to a quirk of English law, it only became a criminal offence to keep a slave in the year 2010. So you've just missed your chance. Who succeeded Harold as King of England in 1066?
Is there a trick to it?
No, it's just you need to name the person who succeeded Harold as king in 1066.
Yeah, well, was it the
don't master? Trust him.
The trick is the trick is to know the answer.
I don't trust you at all.
Is it the bastard then?
Who's the bastard? Oh dear.
See?
Oh, it was not a trick.
Did England cease to exist in some way, or was it changed in name?
There was another Saxon claimant who was nominally king for 45 seconds or something.
Well, for a few months, right. yes. Edgar Aedling. Oh. And he was 15 years old. But Saxon kings were... How did you become a king if you were Saxon?
Did you have to be sort of
You had to be
nominated.
One of the five or six families, and then you'd be elected. Yeah.
Like by what? By votes? They
yes.
They would vote for you?
Yes. Edgar the Aedling. He was 15 years old, but of course William had won the battle, and so he came after him and he tried to fight. He couldn't raise an army, went abroad, you know, didn't really live
well,
a very
15,
successful life.
So he wouldn't have been able to do anything, would he, really?
Edgar the Aedling was proclaimed king by the English after the death of Harold and reigned for 2 months before William was crowned. Who was the first king of both England and Scotland?
James the First.
Is it Canute or something like that?
It's a little later than Canute, but you're right. It's pre-William I.
Oh, dear me.
That's not how the crown looks, by the way. Maybe when the Queen goes to a British Lions rugby match.
She normally has a couple of Coke cans on her.
No, because actually James I was the first one to have what was called the Triple Crown of Scotland, Wales, England and Ireland, but not the first to have the double throne of Scotland and England. Who was?
Ethelbert.
That kind of Athel in
King Engelbert. King Engelbert Humbledink.
Athelstan, King Athelstan, 937
AD. His hand, he's got a hand like a Simpson.
It's incredible we didn't know that.
King Constantine II of Scotland submitted to him in 937, as did the kings of Cornwall, Wales and Northumbria, when he became the first king of all Britain, Athelstan. I would also have allowed Edward I, which is wrong, but not as wrong as James I. Which good cause benefited from Britain's first lottery? Dale Winton. Dale Winton's tanning salon. I'm sure it did very well.
Yeah, there you go.
But it wasn't Britain's first lottery.
Is it the Bank of England?
No, that's a very good point. That was almost like a lottery. That the shares were issued to raise money. And
for the army.
It was virtually like a lottery. But this one was similarly to raise money for a military venture, or at least for a military, perhaps for defence, originally.
The Drake?
Yes, it was indeed in 1567.
It was Drake.
So, well, it was, yeah.
The
it was
Armada.
Doing in my
it
head.
It was, yeah.
Very much in my head.
I'm very impressed. It was Queen Elizabeth and her navy, and indeed Drake was one of her leading figures. There she is.
It was. Guess.
She realised that should King Philip of Spain send the fleet, which in Spanish is
Armada.
Armada, yes.
Sorry. I'm genuinely still reeling from the fact that's in my head.
It's really great when that happens, isn't it?
No, it's odd. It's a little weird.
And so she thought to raise money, she'd try and get those who could afford it to buy lottery tickets, and the prize would be enormous. And the money raised would be enormous. Now, what do you think the average wage was per year?
It can't have been much.
No, it wasn't much. The average annual income in 1600 was about £9.
Oh.
So tickets were 50 pence, we've called it now, 10 shillings each.
That's a lot.
Which is about 3 weeks' wages.
Yeah.
So only the rich would be able to.
Only the rich would be able to. The prize on there was £5,000, £5,000, which is millions today.
By America.
You buy a huge estate. Plus, it was paid partly in cash, but also in gold and silver and fine tapestry and fabrics and something really extraordinary to encourage sales. And this later cropped up in one of the most popular games in our culture, as something that you could tuck away under the board of the game for future
Monopoly,
use.
Monopoly, get out of jail free car.
You've got to get out of jail free car. For anything except murder, serious felonies, treason,
And parking.
Parking your horse, obviously, that was not allowed. Or piracy, obviously, that was one. But everything else was, very good.
Well,
wasn't
I would
it?
Sell tickets now.
Yeah, brilliant idea.
Now, to give the show a bit of a fillip. There have been 2 King Philips of Macedon, 6 King Philips of Spain, 6 King Philips of France, and, of course, 1 King Philip of QI. Yeah. Oh. But when will we get a King Philip of England?
We're not ever alone.
Not never.
Never
say never. In the future.
No, not in the future.
We've had one.
We've had one, but he is not normally taught in the school mnemonics. King Philip of England, he reigned for 4 years, 1554 to 1558. He was actually King Philip II of Spain, but he was King of England and Ireland by virtue of his marriage to Queen Mary, so not a consort like Queen Elizabeth's Prince Philip, but actually crowned king in his own right. So both their faces were on the coins. Parliament was called under their joint authority. And he actually lived in England just under a year, July 1554 to 1555. He married her. He was 27. She was 37. It's kind of an odd thing. He only spoke Castilian Spanish. So the whole marriage must have been conducted through an interpreter.
I wonder what attracted her to him at 27.
Who knows?
She was 37.
It's rather sweet. When she died, he wrote, "I felt a reasonable regret for her death."
Maybe it's better in Spanish.
He proposed marriage to her half-sister, of course, Elizabeth.
Classy.
The Philippines are named after him. He ruled the Spanish
Empire. He had very slim legs.